We move on to the final panel of the day, but the most interesting one, the threat of Wahhabism and terrorism to India. Before I introduce the panelists, I would like to state some facts. 16 out of 19 terrorists of 9/11 were Saudi Wahhabis and rest were Egyptians schooled in the Wahhabi ideology. In the year July 2013, Wahhabism was identified by the European Parliament in Strasbourg as the main source of global terrorism. In 2007, Saudi Arabia was estimated to be spending at least $2 billion annually on promoting Wahhabism worldwide, and by 2015, that figure is believed to have doubled. Who are these Wahhabis and which school of thought do they belong to? Wahhabism is a puritanical strain of Islam and is practiced in Saudi Arabia and Qatar, although it is much less rigidly enforced in the latter. The word Wahhabi derived from the name of the Muslim scholar Muhammad bin Abd al-Wahhab, who lived in the Arabian Peninsula during the 18th century. Wahhabis are considered to be non-believers. Consider non-believers, including followers of Sufi saints, to be infidels. They are more conservative and do not accept many of the beliefs of Sunni Muslims, and they are more aggressively opposed to any cultural influence impacting Muslim practices. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, who was the mentor of Muhammad al-Wahhab, was the author of the Mardin Fatwa, which justified violence against the unjust and the authoritarian rulers so as to re-establish the Islamic rule and the rule of Sharia. Today, this fatwa is being used by the terrorists to justify their attack as Islamic. In India, the proponents of Salafism or Wahhabism are Al-Hadith sect. Significant number of those arrested with suspected links to the ISIS by the NIA are found to be from this sect. World over, there is an anxiety with respect to Wahhabism, and India shares and identifies with this anxiety. To discuss this and more, I would like to call upon my first guest for today, Major General Bakshi. Major General Bakshi is a combat veteran of many skirmishes on the line of control and counter-terrorist operations in Jammu and Kashmir and Punjab. Major General Bakshi has commanded a battalion in Kargil and was awarded the Vishisht Seva Medal. Later, he commanded a brigade in counter-terrorist operations in the rugged mountains of Kishtwar and was awarded the Sena Medal for his distinguished services. He is a prolific writer and has published over 25 books and over 130 papers. He taught in the Indian Military Academy, Dehradun, and the prestigious Defence College staff at Wellington and National Defence College in the New Delhi. He is currently editor of Indian Military Review, known as the Senior Advisor Security with Reliance Industries. Next, I would like to call on stage Ms. Shazia Ilmi, anti-corruption crusader and spokesperson, BJP. A gender activist, dynamic political leader, filmmaker, and former television journalist and anchor, Ms. Shazia Ilmi is currently an independent director on the board of Engineers India and spokesperson of the Global Citizens Forum and the member of the Film Certification Appellate Tribunal. She is also brand ambassador for the Prime Minister's Swachh Bharat Mission. She was among the 9 selected by the Delhi government to spread the message of the cleanliness and hygiene in Delhi. She was a founder member of India's Aam Aadmi Party and served in the party's National Executive Committee from 2012 to 2014. Next, I would like to invite on stage Mr. Sultan Shaheen, founding editor of New Age Islam. Mr. Sultan Shaheen has over 4 decades of experience in national and international journalism. As a human rights defender, he has been representing major international NGOs and participating in debates at the UN Human Rights Council at the Geneva for over a decade. He founded his website, New Age Islam, in April 2008, primarily to map an agenda for Muslims of the 21st century. He considers preventing radicalization and de-radicalization of already radicalized Muslims as his prime concerns in present times. For this, NewAgeIslam.com is focused on refuting point by point the various theological misinterpretations that are being used to subvert the Muslim youth. Ms. Shazia Elmi will be moderating the panel today. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Well, it's great to be a part of this panel. Thank you so much, all of you, for staying back. And this will provide the much-needed caffeine dose that we need at this point of the day. You know, before we go further, I would, I'm so happy to have both of you on the panel to discuss this. Major General Bakshi is the one, when I'm on the television with the Pakistani generals, it is he who comes to my defense and says, we don't need people like you to bash up Shazia because you have brothers like us to have fight for a sister. As for Mr. Sultan Shaheen, he's actually working on a new theology, and we have to take the narrative forward. And this new theology that you talk about encompasses the rationalist Islam, mystical Islam, as well as literalist Islam. Am I right, Sultan Saab? And as for me, besides being a spokesperson, and you see me try to get in a word edgeways with Arnab Goswami's blitzkrieg of words and all of that, I'm also a Maulana's daughter. And yes, my Maulana is from Deoband. So there's no but another disclaimer, before we have a debate like this, is to actually distinguish Islam and Islamism. So Islam is a religion of peace. Islam means peace. Assalamu alaikum and wa alaikum assalam means may peace be on you. But Islamism is the ideology or the thought that takes forward the literalist version, so to speak, over the spiritual outlines of the religion. And of course, you've had this great, brilliant exposition by Maruf Raza on what Wahhabism is. We'll talk more about that. But we'll start with you, General Bakshi. Yeah. You have some slides. Yeah. And tell us what is Wahhabism? It is used interchangeably with Salafism. A lot of people call it petro-Islam. What is this source of funding? And is there a grave threat to India? Because we're looking at the second largest Muslim population in the world.
Thank you, Shazia. Thank you for putting that in perspective. I think just to focus the discussion a little more, as a military man, one would like to frame it in some precise terms. You know, the fact of the matter is, you have this threat of radicalization, which fuels terrorism, not only in India, all over the globe. It's becoming a global phenomenon. So I think you have to get to the roots. When you fight a particular ideology of nihilism, you know, you have to first understand what is it? What is it that motivates the other man? What is it that is hurting him? What is the cause of his angst? You know, now there is this roots of Islamic rage that you have to go to. Why is the Islamic society so angry today? I mean, there is, it's not a manufactured rage. It is genuine rage which is there, and we are suffering the consequences of that. You know, most of it stems from the fact that Islam is one of the religions which had, you know, created an empire within 100 years from starting from Iraq, Saudi Arabia, that region. It had conquered almost the whole of Central Asia, Iran. It had come up to the borders of Afghanistan.
I don't want to come in the way of the...
This is large. Okay, sorry. So as I was saying, you know, it had spread into North Africa. It had reached Spain. Then there is this angst about the loss of empire. 18th century onwards, you know, the Mughal Empire at one stage was generating 45% of the world's GDP. The Mughal Empire was generating at one stage 45% of the world GDP, the other 45% coming from China, and the rest, you know, was that. And from that glorious pinnacles to suddenly come to being colonized, to being reduced to absolute servitude, to having, you know, the Europeans run all over you. So there was lots of this angst and rage. And then why, what went wrong? What went wrong with us? This roots of this rage, if you see, in the subcontinent, it took place, it took the form of Deoband, Jamaat-e-Islami, Jamaat-e-Ulema, who tried to come up with answers of why and where did we go wrong. In the Middle East, you have Wahhabism, under, and then that leads to, you know, the Ahle Hadith and the Aqwanul Muslimin, the Muslim Brotherhood of Hassan al-Banna, and that's from where it all starts. And their prescriptive base was, look, we have fallen from grace because we have fallen from the original purity of the Islam that was practiced in the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And we have fallen from that grace because we have not stuck to our original principles. We have been contaminated as we went along. You know, the Ashraf and the Alaf, we all know. So the locals who have come in, brought in their inputs into Islam, their peers, fakirs, etc., have contaminated Islam. And because we have lost our purity, we are where we are today. I thought this analysis went a little awry, because the loss of Islam was due because at one stage they were the leaders in technology. They had the technology of guns. Forging was not taught to anybody else in India, except they kept the secret with them. Forging guns, forging siege cannons, forging the horse-drawn cannons, etc., was all there. They didn't focus on that loss of technological basis, the competence, etc., but they went towards going back to your roots. Now, when you talk of the Islamic ideological ferment in India, in the subcontinent, right? There were two basic schools of thought that emerged over here from the 17th century down to about 1947. One of these strands was represented by a gentleman called Maulana Abdul Allah Maududi. Now, I don't think the rest of the world has caught on to the criticality of this man and his thinking in what fuels terrorism today. General Ziaul Haq, incidentally, used to go around in Pakistan giving out his book, Al-Jihad-e-Islam.
True.
And I'm surprised there is no English translation till date. We'd ask the army to do it and sort of get up these books, because General Ziaul Haq used to be giving out these books. And you know, he came to we saw the crystallization of two very different, radically different concepts. One, Maulana Abdul Allah Maududi said, there is no question of a nation state in Islam. Islam, the Ummah, is global. It is sans boundaries. Yes. It cannot be confined to a nation state. You know, and he said, Hakumat-e-Ilahi, or the sovereignty of the Lord, versus the sovereignty of the state. He says the sovereignty of the state is a sin to talk of the sovereignty of the state. You see, the other strand that crystallized and that actually then came to the fore was the struggle for the formation of a territorial centric nation state, the nation state of Islam, which would, you know, be for the Muslims of the subcontinent, the nation state of Pakistan. And this came very, very, very late towards the freedom struggle. It's in the 1920s onward, you suddenly see the school of thought coming to the fore. And of course, Muhammad Ali Jinnah is the founder. And then you have Field Marshal Ayub Khan. Just take a look at this. If you understand it in ideological terms, the only ideology, you know, that was global was communism. That appealed across horizontal frontiers was communism. Communism said, workers of the world unite, you have nothing to lose but your chains. And they said the vertical class conflict supersedes horizontal conflict between nations, and hence wherever the communists are in trouble, we are going to, you know, intervene, we are going to take place. Now, some experts, they draw a comparison between this, between jihad ideology, which they say has replaced communism as the new ideological threat to the Westphalian system of nation states. This jihad ideology, I'm not talking of Islamic ideology. I, like you, distinguish between Islamism. In the armed forces, we use the term jihadi ideology. Divides the world into two antithetical spaces, Darul Islam, where the pious rule, and Darul Harb, or the land of war. I mean, wherever else it is not there is the land of war. It has to be conquered, overtaken, etc. Jihad ideology postulates the concept of a global ummah that recognizes no national frontiers, which impels jihadis to intervene across the world in, in Bosnia, Chechnya, Xinjiang, Central Asia, Jammu and Kashmir, Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand, etc. Right? The foremost ideologues of jihad were Hasan al-Banna of the Ikhwanul Muslimin, that is the Islamic Brotherhood, yeah, and Abdul Allah Maududi, founder of Jamaat-e-Islami Pakistan. Like I said, his book Al-Jihad had become the Bible. It was the Mein Kampf, more or less, for General Ziaul-Haq. And he said the Hukumat-e-Ilahi, or the sovereignty of God, as opposed to the sovereignty of the nation state, said sovereignty was blasphemous, it was kufr. Maududi had opposed the idea of Pakistan. He had opposed the formation of Pakistan as a normal territorial centric nation state. The Ummah, he felt, was global and could not be confined within national boundaries.
And also because he felt that the actual job of conversion would be limited to
Pakistan as opposed to the larger subcontinent. Absolutely right you are. Now, you know, when we had discussions in Jammu and Kashmir, we invited the ulema, we invited the Sufi scholars. It was very enlightening to hear them debate this issue. Theologically, the argument of Maududi is seriously flawed.
Yes.
The argument on which all this terrorism is being done seriously flawed from the Quranic point of view. The Lord of the Quran is the Lord of the entire Kainat. He is not the Lord of the Muslimin. He is not confined to any one nation state. He is the Lord of the cosmos. He is the Lord of the universe. How then can you confine him to, you know, the Lord only of the Muslimin? Right? This is the argument that we heard from the Sufi scholars and the others in Jammu and Kashmir. And actually, we found that when they presented this argument, there was silence onto the other side. Maududi was greatly impressed by the fanaticism of the fascist, Nazi, communist cadres. He believed in the asymmetry of will. Asymmetry of will, you see, a nation state, your will to hold on in Jammu and Kashmir. You find 70 years and there are voices, no, let them go. This is weakness of will. This is what Maududi and his ilk, he said, look at the fascists, look at the communist cadres. A minority of them can keep a nation under thrall. And this is the model that he proposed for the jihadi, you know, thing that we see, the cult of the Amir. Please understand, early Islam was a highly democratic religion, egalitarian.
Yes. Yes.
What was the appeal of Islam? It is egalitarian. Rich, high, or low, poor, they all go to the mosque and there is no, you know, seats reserved for anybody. There is no front line reserved for anyone.
Universal brotherhood and
there is that brotherhood.
Social equality.
You see, from that, you now come to the cult of the Amir. Fascist, undemocratic, relied upon the messianic personality of leaders, fanatic modules led by Amirs would dominate entire populations into meek submission. And this is where I come to a central tenet today, a takeaway from this discussion, that we will get to the end of this scourge of jihadism only when the moderate Muslim majority stands up and speaks up, like it happened in the Punjab. The turning point came when the ordinary moderate ordinary Punjabis, the middle class, those who wanted just peace, their children to study and to get a job, they stood up. That was the time terrorism ended. So I think we'll have to look for that kind of a rise, and we see the first stirrings of it, and I'm very happy to note, especially in our country. So there was this coercive minority of zealots, which is the very antithesis of democracy and representative forms of government. Now this slide shows you the growth of madrasas in Pakistan. Just see, till 1947 there were 245 madrasas in Pakistan. By the time you come to 1980, you see it shooting up to 8,000. Then it went by 2005 to 11,882 registered madrasas. If you count the unregistered madrasas, it comes to 45,000 in all. And the breakdown in Deobandi, Brelvi and the Ahl-e-Hadith is on the slide in front of you, right? What was this due to? 1979, the Russians invaded Afghanistan. Pakistan was lying truncated, broken, bruised by the 71 war. It had been broken into two. It suddenly gets a new lease of life. Funds are pumped in, weapons are pumped in. They are allowed to go nuclear because now they are running the Afghan jihad. for the CIA and the Mukhabarat of the Saudi Arabians. Very few people know that the CIA put in $5 billion into this jihad, and the Saudi Arabian Mukhabarat intelligence agency matched them dollar for dollar. That is the amount of money that was pumped in. There are more small arms free floating in Afghanistan than they are there with the combined armies of India and Pakistan. A new form of war, asymmetric war, jihad. Millions of Qurans were published, pushed into Afghanistan, into Central Asia, and the AFPAC, AFPAC belt of madrasas became a factory for producing these kind of jihadis. Now, Ahmad Rashid says the greatest weakness of the Ikhwan model of political Islam is its dependence on a single charismatic leader or amir rather than a more democratically constituted organization to lead it. The obsession of radical Islam is not the creation of institutions, but the perceived character and purity of its leader. Nawaz Sharif sahab ko abhi isi pe nikal diya gaya. Okay. The Afghan war was the first successful resistance to a foreign power, which was not based on either nationalist or socialist principles, but instead on Islamic principle. It was waged as a jihad and gave a tremendous boost to Islamic self-confidence and power. Its impact on the Islamic world was in effect comparable to the impact which the Japanese victory in 1905 had on the rest of Asia. My God, an Asian power can defeat a European power. So similarly, we have beaten the Russians. If we can beat the Russians, what the hell are the Indians? We will take them on. You see, and this is Samuel Huntington. The war left behind an uneasy coalition of Islamic organizations intent on promoting Islam against all non-Muslim forces. It also left a legacy of expert and experienced fighters, camps, training grounds, and logistic facilities. Elaborate trans-Islam networks of personal and organizational relationships and a substantial amount of military equipment. Most important, it gave a heady sense of power and self-confidence over what had been achieved and a driving desire to move on to other victories. This is again Samuel Huntington, right? And that is why you find their next focus comes on to India. Hussein Haqqani says, unfortunately, during the process of the tactical use of ideology to further short-term agendas and narrow political and personal objectives, the very character and chemistry of the Pakistani state was changed forever. Today, Pakistan is at great risk of becoming a theocracy than it ever was before. We just have had ads of Hafiz Saeed. You know, I wouldn't be surprised Hafiz Saeed for Prime Minister or President. he's already formed a party and he's contesting, right? So Ziaul Haq's use of ideology subverted the very character and nature of the Pakistani nation state. From a nation state, he transformed it into an ideological bridgehead for exporting jihadi causes all over the world. Ladies and gentlemen, please understand one thing. A modern nation state, a Westphalian nation state, is premised upon the monopoly of violence with the state and a disarmed population. The first imperative for establishing a country, a nation state, is to disarm the population. All the, you know, Samant, Kiledars, Talukdars, Subedars, Mansabdars have to be disarmed. Only then can you form a nation state. When you rearm your own population, you are undercutting the basis of the nation state, and Pakistan has done just that. There's a 550,000 strong Pakistan army. There's a 250,000 strong jihadi tanzeems, these so-called cartoon networks. Lashkar-e-Toyba, you know, Harkatul Jihad, Islami, Jaish-e-Mohammed, etc., etc. The madrasas of the AFPAC border are still today the key incitatory network of Talibani ideology. We know the rest. And we have the paradox of Pakistan, which is a failed state, almost facing financial collapse. It's either shored up by the Americans and Saudis. When they give up, the Chinese have stepped in with $51 billion. So help us God. Now, the growth of the jihadi organizations. In the Deobandi organizations, we had Jamaat-e-Islami, which gave rise to the Hizbul Mujahideen, which is the one which is fighting us in Pakistan, and the Al-Badr. The Jamaat-e-Ulema has fathered the Harkatul Ansar, which became the Jaish-e-Muhammad, which became the Tehreek al-Furqan, and all the names that they keep doing. The Jamaat-e-Ulema-e-Islami came into the Fazlur Rahman faction, the Sami'ul Haq faction, and of course we had the TUM and the Sipah-e-Sabah Pakistan. I'll rush through this. Now the Wahhabi strain. You know, this took the inspiration from the Ahl-e-Hadith, and the three wings that were formed were the Tariq-e-Nifaz-e-Sunnat-e-Muhammad, the Jamaat-e-Ulema-e-Ahl-e-Hadith, which transformed into Markazul Dawa wal-Irshad, Lashkar-e-Toyba, then Pasban-e-Ahl-e-Hadith, and now the latest name is Jamaatul Dawa. It's been changed once more. Tariq-e-Tulba Students Organization in Pakistan, sorry. Now, I would like to set the stage for the discussion. The rest, I think, we will cover in the, you know, the more free-flowing format.
Yes.
Early Islam, ladies and gentlemen, you know, Islam has three pillars. Ijtihad, the doctrine of independent reasoning. Every Muslim is free to read the Quran and come to his own conclusions. He doesn't need a priest cult to interpret the Quran for him. He's free to read it himself, to his own independent reasoning. Ijma, the consensus of the community. When the Prophet, peace be upon him, was about to pass away and he knew that his time had come, he called his followers and he told them. So they were quite distraught. So they said, what will happen to us after you go? Who will guide us? He said, the Holy Quran is there. That will guide you. He said, what if we don't find the answers in the Quran? Then he said, go to the learning. Those who know the Quran well, those who are, you know, there are of course different Shia and Sunni interpretations to this. But he says, go to the learning. He said, what if they can't give us the answer? Then he said, then it is the will of the community or the consensus of the community. The will of the people, the voice of the people is the voice of God. So just see how democratic and liberal these two initial pillars, the two pillars of Islam are. Unfortunately, when the struggle started for the succession in the caliphate, and each had to pure that, look, I have a greater claim to be the caliph, you know, khalifa, than the other. That is the time then you started looking for ideological purity. You started looking for customary reports, eyewitness reports of the customary practices of the Prophet and his companions. And that is how Ahl-e-Hadith, the Hadiths came in, and then fiqh, Islamic jurisprudence, concept of the rule of Sharia, and the conservative idealized past in a period of declining political legitimacy. So we today, I would say that Islam, and I would request the greater scholars of the religion to speak on this, there is a need for possibly Islam and for us to focus more on ijtihad and ijma, get back to ijtihad and ijma, and focus less on this strain which has led to radicalization and distortions. And I'll just... I think there was the J&K based thing. Would you like me to cover it, or we can do that in the discussion?
You want to do it now? We can go back to it later.
Oh, we can go back to it. Okay.
So coming to you, now this was again a very detailed big understanding of where this started, and how much do you agree there's so many between the Sufi Islam and the Salafist Islam and the overall Wahhabism and all the funding that goes on, and within the Sunni school, the fiqh, the different schools of jurisprudence, whether it's Hanbali or Hanafi or Maliki or Shafi, where is a liberal Muslim stuck today, really? And I want to understand from you, because when you hear, and when you hear somebody like Sartaj Aziz say and tell the Kashmiri Muslims that what is this Sufi Islam or Kashmiriyat, you are a Muslim. So this call to religious identity and political identity within the religion, how do you see that, do you see that growing? Is there a cause of worry for you? How do you explain this for us and take us through this maze of this terminology of Wahhabism, Salafism, and the various schools of jurisprudence, and where do we stand today in India as the second largest Muslim population in the world?
Well, Mr. Shazia, Islam is one thing, and Islamic theology or your understanding of Islam is something quite different.
Yes.
And you can have your own understanding, I can have my own. And gradually theology of Islam has developed, encompassing the entire, not only Wahhabi or Salafi, even the mainstream Sufi,
yeah,
theology, not the Sufi thoughts, not what the Sufi said,
yeah,
has developed into a theology of violence, theology of exclusion, theology of supremacism and domination and gender inequality,
yes,
patriarchalism, you know. It has happened over the years. Extremism is nothing new in Islam. Mm. It has existed since, at least since Hazrat Ali's time, who was the fourth caliph.
That's right.
Just 20 odd years after the death of the Prophet, there was a group which was later called Khawarij. Khawarij means those who have seceded, who have gone out of Islam. But this is what the mainstream Islam called them, Khawarij. Those who have gone out of Islam. Today's Wahhabis or Jihadis are called Neo-Khawarij. So the same tradition is continuing, and these people had fought both Hazrat Ali as well as Muawiyah, who were fighting among themselves.
That's right.
And they were part of the Hazrat Ali's army to begin with.
Yes.
But then they had ideological, theological differences with him, and so they left him and they finally assassinated him as well. They killed a large number of Muslims of both the groups. So this third group emerged. Now Khawarij have always been there throughout these 1400 years of history, sometimes dominant, most of the times not so dominant, and mainstream Islam has nearly always been able to kind of discredit them and take them out. Now the situation is very different, because the last 45 years, since 1974, when Saudi Arabia got so much money in petrodollars, they have spent tens of billions of dollars in spreading their ideology, which is the secessionist ideology from Islam, which is a new ideology in a sense.
Yes.
But it is based on Islam. You cannot say that you are not a Muslim. You cannot fight takfirism with takfirism. Like some Muslims say, oh, jihadis are not Muslims at all, so let us wash our hands of them. We can't do that. They are Muslims. You have to accept that. Only thing they are saying, we are more true, we are more rigid, we are more... How they have managed to do that? How has this theology come into existence? This is what we have to focus on. What they have done is...
But countering that, even those who don't practice Islam the way it's supposed to be practiced in terms of hijab or donning the beard, which is part of the sunnah, so to speak, also that can't be judged. And they also cannot be considered as any less Muslims as others who would want to follow them.
What you have to see is that what they have done is that they are using the same Islamic terminology as other Muslims use. For instance, Tawheed is a part of Islam. Every Muslim would say, I am a Muwahid, which means I believe in one God.
Oneness, yeah.
But what they do, they have taken it to its extreme.
Yes.
Which is, they say that if you seek help from anyone other than God, even in worldly matters, I am looking for a job, I go to somebody and say, can you help, please help me. Now, by doing that, in their view, in their theology, I am making this person equal to God, partner with God, which means I am practicing shirk, which means I am become liable to be killed by them because I am a mushrik. So, I mean, this kind of extreme that they have taken to. Then what they have done is they have changed the meanings of the commonly used Islamic terminologies. Like, for instance, a word like kafir or kufr or kafirin.
Kufr or kafir.
Now, generally, every Muslim will tell you, not only others, that kafir means non-Muslims or infidels or polytheists or whosoever is not a Muslim.
Non-believers.
For a Wahhabi, kafir means a non-Wahhabi, even if he's a Muslim.
Yes.
Right.
And for Ahle Sunnat, would it be?
Yeah, but in Quran, if you go to Quran, you find in three places expressions like kafirin, minal mushrikeen wal ahle kitab. At three places in Quran, I found this. Now, what it means? It means kafirs among the polytheists, kafirs among the ahle kitab, which means Christians, Jews, Hindus, etc.
That's right.
Right. So, how can all the polytheists be kafir then? If Quran is saying, and then Quran has also explained what kafir means, which means oppressor. Essentially, a kafir is somebody who does not allow others practicing their religion. Essentially, this is the meaning of kafir in Quran, and this has been explained, if I recall correctly, at least 6 places. And in 3 places, God has talked about kafirin among mushrikeen and kafirin among Christians and kafirin among Jews and so on.
Right.
So the kafir, so they have changed the whole meaning of the word kafir.
So this has happened with a lot of terms. In fact, when you talk about jihad, and I hardly like to use that because jihad is purification, realization, actualization, and a struggle. And we all go through our daily jihads day after day. So jesh, the beautiful word like jesh. So that one is the need for us to reclaim what is true Islam, and the second need, and most importantly, is really to get back the narrative of what Islam is meant to be and what it is to be a Muslim today. Because a lot of Muslims find themselves in a very hard place, you know, between the Islamophobes and the radical Islamists, there is this huge wide terrain to look at. So what do you suggest, General Bakshi, what needs to be done from now onwards to counter this? Because obviously the Wahhabi strain is becoming more and more predominant. There is a lot of money coming in. There's a whole IB report saying that so many more mosques in Kashmir and many more in Kerala and now in Maharashtra are being fueled by this. Is there need, you think, for some kind of administrative mechanism to look into what is happening in the dargahs, in the masjids, in these seminaries, so to speak, and to see where the funding is coming from?
Excellent. Firstly, apropos the issue of jihad, and he'll bear me out, Dr. Saab will bear me out. Afzal jihad, Asghar jihad. What is the higher form of jihad is my, when I battle within my soul, with my evil tendencies, with my tendency to, you know, do the wrong things.
Yes.
I battle that for my own moral purity. That is the superior jihad.
Yeah.
And the other form, Asghar jihad, is supposed to be waged when people are obstructing the practice of your religion, when they are destroying mosques, when they are not letting the muezzin give his call, when they are obstructing people from praying in the mosque. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I have physically captured, interrogated so many of these people sent from across Pakistan.
Yes.
And they told us, Saab, we were told that mosques are being destroyed. You know, nobody is allowed to give the muezzin's call. Nobody can go and pray. We have found everything very, you know, I mean, absolutely normal, as good as it is in Pakistan, if not better. So that is the kind of a concept. But coming to how this danger that is being posed, and this is where the Kashmir model gives us instructive lessons. Look, I'll just summarize this. I will not show the slides. I'll summarize this. 1947, Kashmir, an oasis of peace and quiet amongst a raging storm of butchery. With the partition, the butchery of, you know, hundreds of thousands of people on both sides. South Asia was in flames. Which was the only place which was peaceful and quiet? Jammu and Kashmir. Why? Because they had a Sufi syncretic version of Islam,
absolutely,
which called the peers Nyunda Riosh.
Yeah.
Nyunda Riosh means Nyunda Rishi.
Yes.
The peer was called Rishi by the Hindus. So it was that Sufi syncretic culture of Islam which kept peace. It was an oasis of peace amongst the raging inferno of communal violence. What has happened today? 1980s onwards, a concerted program of mosque building, as he has told you, 600 mosques came up in Srinagar itself. And they actually started trying to frown on and trying to, you know, prevent the other dargahs and the other, you know, the sharifs that we have, Chirar-e-Sharif and the other sharif, to prevent people from going there and to preach a very, very radicalized version of Islam.
Yes.
In the mosques and in the madrasas, tapes were sent from across, material was sent from across. Believe you me, I've heard those tapes. And if you hear them, your skin will crawl. Venomous communal hatred being bred.
Yes.
The pity is that the government chose to look the other way. Farooq Abdullah Sahab, instead of taking this head on, which he should have done, because this was taking it to one level.
Every Jumu'ah ki namaz in the khutbah is this kind of...
You see, so when this communalization...
These are the conversations and these are the khutbahs.
The problem is that it has taken them 30 years to radicalize the valley, Wahhabize the valley. Reduce the valley 80 by 80 square kilometers with 5 million people into one vast ghetto.
Yes.
Where, you know, there are ghettos outside Paris where the security forces can't go in. There are ghettos outside Brussels where the no-go areas for the police. Right? And in these ghettos, then you are giving full play to this radicalized form of Islam. And you know, there was this question, why is the recruitment more in Europe? Because there he feels the difference, you know, how he's being treated. Here, I mean, the Muslims part of the mainstream.
So taking from what General Bakshi just mentioned, I'll come to you, Sultan Saab. When you hear that, and when you see in a place like Aligarh Muslim University, from the time of my sister when she studied there to now, 80-90% of Muslim girls wearing the burqa, covering themselves, using headscarves and more than that, the niqab, so to speak. Many more young boys in UP donning the beard as part of the sunnah, so to speak. And of course, a good old Khuda Hafiz become Allah Hafiz. The going from the Iranic way of saying Khuda Hafiz to a more austere Allah Hafiz. Is there reason to worry? Are the Indian Muslims getting radicalized? Are we being lured in some way, numbers of us, by this kind of conversation?
You see, the only theology available today is the theology of domination and supremacy. Mm-hmm. The theology of pluralism and peace that we need is just not there. It may be there in bits and pieces in, what Sufis said here and there. But what Sufis did was that they merely focused on the positives of Islam. They did not take on the extremists.
That's right.
They did not counter them.
Yes.
One, there was no particular need for that.
Yes.
Because most of the people were, there was no terrorism as it is today, there was no Wahhabism which was being spread at the cost of tens of billions of dollars all across the world. Today you have Muslim societies, every Muslim society can produce an army of suicide bombers. Now suicide is the most difficult thing, if not impossible, for you to promote. I mean, how can you ask somebody to commit suicide? What will you give him? And in Islam, suicide is one of the most heinous crimes.
Yes.
You see, one of the companions of the Prophet, who was a Ghazi, who had come back from battle, he was very seriously wounded and he was in great pain. And unable to bear that pain, he committed suicide. He killed himself. The Prophet refused to go to his funeral. He said he is going to hell. Because life is the most precious gift.
Yes.
How can you give up? And so what can you give somebody? And yet, in Muslim societies, anywhere in the world today, you can create a whole army of suicide bombers. In India too, you can certainly do that. Most of the madrasa kids, one of the songs they sing is, Zindagi shuru hoti hai qabr mein.
Akhirat.
Qabr mein, this is after death. I mean, your life begins.
Akhirat, yes.
So this life is of no consequence.
It's not about life, but the afterlife.
What you need to do to turn this person into a suicide bomber? Nothing much.
True.
So there is a reason why this is happening. You see, you have been talking about Sufism and mysticism, and there seems to be great hope being pinned on Sufism.
Yes.
But today, Sufism itself is Wahhabized, even in India. Indian Sufi madrasas have stopped teaching Sufi books. Till 30 years ago, there is a whole list of books that I found out that was being taught. You see, there are some Sufi Maulanas who work for my foundation, and I talked to their fathers and them. The books that their fathers had read are no longer being taught to them. These people have not read those books. Even Gulistan Bosta, you may have read in your own childhood as well, is not being taught anymore. The reason they give Sufi madrasas is that Persian does not bring jobs. So we are teaching Arabic, fine. But then I asked them, why are you then teaching Sayyid Qutb? You see, if you are teaching Arabic, fine. But why are you teaching Sayyid Qutb? They say, we are not teaching milestones of Sayyid Qutb. We are only teaching his fiction. Because Sayyid Qutb was originally a novelist and fiction writer. Later on, he became what he became. So, but the thing is, why do you want to introduce your children, your students to Sayyid Qutb? Somebody like that who is considered the grandfather of today's jihadis. along with Maulana Maududi.
Yes.
Khalil Qutb learned from Maulana Maududi. Maulana Maududi was the original person here. One thing that also you should understand is that there is a reason why Wahhabism has found acceptability everywhere else in the world, even in India, for instance. Now, when I say India, I mean the Indian subcontinent, right? How, why has it found acceptability? It because our own theologians, great theologians like Sheikh Sirhindi or Shah Waliullah Dehlavi, whose Hujjatullah al-Balagha is found in practically every Muslim home. All these people are saying practically the same thing that Ibn Taymiyyah said or Abdul Wahhab said later. I mean, I have quotations from them here, but we don't have time to go into that.
Yes.
But you must understand that the Shah Waliullah Dehlavi, who is very, very popular among Muslims in India, all religious Muslim families have Shah Waliullah Dehlavi's books in their home. Sheikh Sirhindi, whose Maktubat is very, very popular. Maktubat means letters. He used to write letters to a lot of people, which have been collected now. This is very popular. Now, Sheikh Sirhindi fought against Akbar, because Akbar was using Sufi concept of Sulh-e-Kul, of peace with all.
That's right.
That's right.
And Sheikh Sirhindi is not doing that.
Yeah.
Right? So we ourselves in India, that is the Indian continent, have a long tradition of extremism. And apart from that, even somebody like Ghazali, you see, Ghazali is the Sufi, who is considered somebody whose understanding of Islam is only next to Muhammad.
Yes.
If there is one revered person among Muslims across the board, it is Ghazali. And what does Ghazali say? Ghazali says Muslims should go on jihad at least once a year. Now, once a year cannot be a defensive jihad. It has to be an offensive jihad. It has to be a jihad to go to dominate. So this thought that Islam has to run the world, Islam has to rule the world, Islam has to dominate the world, runs through our veins. That the fact that we are superior to other people runs through our veins. This is not in Quran, however. I must explain, this is not in Quran. In Quran, Muslims and others should compete with each other in doing good deeds. This is Quranic verse, that you should compete with others in doing good deeds. That is all. And then we seem to believe that only Muslims will go to heaven, the rest will go to hell. This is again not in Quran. Quran is clearly, specifically saying this, that everybody will be judged according to their work, their good deeds. And good deeds is the criterion.
There's no advanced booking for
gender. The criterion in Quran is taqwa, which is moral uprightness. Now, what is moral uprightness? It is defined in Quran. And this definition is a wonderful definition. The first sentence of this definition of taqwa, taqwa is what you are supposed to achieve, that is moral uprightness.
That's right.
Now, this definition of taqwa in Quran starts with one negative sentence, which says, this is the, I think every tablighi should read it, they don't. It says, taqwa is not praying facing east or west. The first sentence of this definition is that taqwa is not your daily ritual prayer.
Ritual.
And then it goes on to say that taqwa means that you look after the orphan, you look after the wayfarer, you look after your neighbor, you look after your parents, this and that, only good deeds. So taqwa comes not from praying five times a day or fasting or anything, it comes from moral uprightness and for doing good to other people. But this is not emphasized.
But Sultan Sahib, a very important question and something that I face, and ever since I was a young girl, and I'm sure many Muslims in my situation would feel, we hear about what Quran actually is and how it's interpreted. Now, what are the three sources of understanding Quran for the benefit of those who might not know about it? There is good old Quran, the original source, the holy book, which is immutable, and immutability also becomes an issue, we'll discuss that. And there is hadith, which is many, many interpretations. There are almost 3 lakh schools and different interpretations. Of course, Bukhari Sahib's version is most reliable and considered. And there is Sunnah, the life of the Prophet, the way Huzur, the embodiment of it all, embraced the life and conducted himself. Now, what was very shocking for me, I was part of the Triple Talaq debates, as you all know, was that there are people, Ahle Hadith, so to speak, and all schools and seminaries in India, which were ready to dilute the word of Quran to promote the work of hadith, one particular hadith more than others. Now that is absolutely shocking and disturbing. So to dilute the word of Quran and to call yourself a true Muslim and to uphold a hadith which contravenes the word of Quran so clearly, because Quran talks about only talaqe hasan or ehsan superior to and the only way, then talaqe bidat. And all the schools, whether they were Deobandis or Barelvis, they were all fighting, all us women activists and many men activists as well on the issue, decrying the word of Quran. Don't you find that disturbing? And what do you attribute that to?
Well, see, the Quran's eternal message is something which has to be understood, that Quran started coming in Mecca when the Prophet was living there peacefully. And the verses that came in Mecca are preaching pluralism, good neighborliness, and good deeds, and peace, and everything. Then the Meccan elite responds to it aggressively, and Prophet is thrown out. Once he goes to Medina, again they pursue him there. Then after 13 years of Islam's revelations coming, he is permitted to fight. Now suppose the Meccan elite had merely responded in a manner like this. They would have said, oh, this is a madman, he has 50 followers, what does it matter, let him be.
Yes.
Suppose they had said that, Prophet would not have gone to Medina. Now, even after going to Medina, if the Meccan elite had said, okay, he has gone out, let us forget him. Again, had they not pursued him, there would have been no need for existential crisis for the Prophet to defend himself and fight. So these wartime verses would not have come. So wartime verses are entirely contextual in nature.
Yes.
And there is no reason, you see, sir, you are somebody, a general in the army. You give your troops this order today, if there is war, go out and kill.
Absolutely.
But tomorrow there is ceasefire, that order is rescinded.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So it is these kind of orders. So I must be able to say that these wartime verses of Quran that came in Medina are no longer applicable to me today. We are not fighting Jange Uhud and Jange Badr and so on.
True.
But you will not find a single Maulana, a single Alim anywhere on the face of the earth who will say that these verses, not even the Sufis.
And nobody will speak against polygamy, because there is no Karbala or Jung going on at this point of time, but nobody will touch that.
So Quranic verses are universal in nature, but those verses, I have set two criteria for this, sir. One is that verses in Quran, which are also found more or less in the same manner in Vedas and in Upanishads, in Gita, in Bible and so on, in all the other holy books. Because Islam is saying that it is not a new religion, it is a reiteration and revalidation of all the religions that have come before Islam through 124,000 prophets who were sent all over the world in every corner of the world. And Quran is saying that I have come only to revalidate what was said before. So those verses in Quran which are saying the same thing that you also find in Vedas are of universal nature.
Absolutely.
That is one criterion I use.
Yes.
Another criterion I use is verses of Quran which can be understood without any reference to context are of universal nature. You see, you are being told to speak the truth. Now, you don't need a context to understand that.
That is
universal. You know? Similarly, you are being told, look after your neighbors.
Yes.
You don't need a reference point to a context to understand that. So verses of Quran which are not, you know, of contextual nature, are certainly universal in nature. I mean, so contextual verses, we have to be able to say that those verses which came in this particular context are no longer applicable.
But that would also entail questioning the immutability of the text of the Holy Book, one, and also raising other questions about.
No, but can I just intervene here? This is where I'd like to go back to the three pillars of Islam. Ijma, Ijtihad. They give you this thing to that every Muslim is free to read the Quran and
sir,
come to his own conclusion.
Sir, Ijma has been so widely misused.
And interpreted too.
I use the word tyranny of Ijma. Why? Because what happens is, that you will not go to all the Muslims and ask for their votes on interpretation. So the mullahs will come together.
Yes.
And they will do that.
And they will create a violent interpretation of something.
So that
and they will say that this is the ijma. This is the consensus. And it's tyrannical. I mean, it's very, very difficult. I have some quotations right here, but you know, we don't have time for that.
My limited point was that you see, with the spread of modern information technology, and the people of the faith have taken up very well to use of the internet. You see, you can now reach out to a larger mass and get their views.
You need resources for that.
And will just come to
Saudi
that.
Arabia is therefore, to give you resources.
Therefore, you see, and what it is being used for actually, if I may just skip a few slides ahead, can I?
Yes, I want to actually take the discussion now away from the historical perspective in theology to today.
And where
India,
do we go from here?
So two questions. You see what's happening in the country right now. Now, how can any government, especially the Modi government, and I'm so glad to be in a moderator's chair and not a panelist chair, because I really should have asked me this question, but I escaped that. Never, the question stays, how can the government look at this issue in all its graveness and actually look at having some kind of mechanism to understand ways and means to fight obscurantism? See what is going on in the madrasas to ensure mainstreaming, so to speak, and fight off the Wahhabi strain with the actual universal truth and verses that are for Muslims without sounding communal. So that becomes a big issue for this particular government. How do you see that challenge? And my second question, which will be to you, this is a historic verdict of triple talaq that we had. Now, how long will it take for the community to internalize, assimilate and accept this? Because while the Indian Muslims follow the civil code and CRPC in civil and criminal matters, they follow the personal law in there for matters of matrimony, divorce and succession. So two questions to both of you, and then we leave the floor open. We have 20 minutes in all.
Where do we go from here?
Yes.
The point is we take lessons from our past of the what has happened in Jammu and Kashmir, the way it went. That was not the way it should have gone.
Yes.
Had we acted in time and had we acted with alacrity to, you know, weed out this kind of a propaganda, which then led to 450,000, you know, pundits being thrown out. They can't still go back because of that vitiated environment. So the vitiation of the environment has to stop. My personal belief is nobody can enforce anything from outside. It would be counterproductive to even try. It has to come from within Islam, and there are many moderate voices. We have people here who are enlightened Muslims, patriotic to the core, who make huge contributions. We've had three presidents who have been Muslim, one Air Force chief, you name it, so many army commanders. I mean, just to name a few. So there are moderate Muslim voices. And I think the government has to see that these moderate Muslim voices are supported, if need be, protected, so that no hothead, you know, tries to, anybody who's speaking sense, tries to sort of, assassinate him or these kind of things. And you find even from the ulema, there are people who are talking in a very sensible manner. I can give a few names. I don't want to get into very personal names, but there are a number of them who are speaking very sensibly. This is the only community, Muslim community, which has issued fatwas against terrorism as un-Islamic. I mean, no other Muslim community in the world has done it. So firstly, this reform must come from within. We must stress more on that ijtihad, independent reasoning, where what he very rightly brings out as the core perennial philosophy, which can be taken without context, that should be emphasized, that should be given, you know, a precedence over those which have a context. Which may no longer be relevant. For example, let me tell you, in the Arabian society of the desert, nothing grows. There is a tradition of ghazu. Every year, you have to go and raid the other tribe, plunder, and then get back from the more settled areas, you know, whatever you needed, because nothing used to grow in Saudi Arabia. You see, so the ghazu tradition, if it is just reinterpreted, it has a context. That context is not relevant. You are not in Saudi Arabia. That context is not relevant. And therefore, what he very rightly, I think that needs to be emphasized, the core perennial aspect of the Quran now needs to be stressed, and it has to be by Muslim voices if it has to bear credence.
So it has to come from within
it
the community.
It has to come from within. It will have to come from within. The moderate Muslim majority must today stand up and be counted. And the government must help that process.
And Sultan Sahab, to you, the question of today, like we saw with this historic verdict, and now we're looking ahead and going ahead, and more Muslim women are clamoring for gender justice and wanting more, and a more equitable, democratic version of human rights, as opposed to what rights given within the Sharia, because we are not a theocratic nation, but a democratic nation. I would like to ask you, how long will it take? I mean, the legislation is doing its bit, you know, the Supreme Court passed this historic verdict. But from within the community, how long will it take for it to be internalized, strengthened, and assimilated? The democratization of women's rights, that as one. And also see Muslims as seeing themselves as a larger themselves mainstream, not just seeking a separate religious identity, but seeing themselves as citizens of this huge democracy that is India.
Well, Muslims already see themselves as part of this huge democracy, and democracy is something which is very, very popular among Muslims as well as among other communities.
Yes.
That's not the issue. Internalizing this verdict and its implications will take long time, because the ulema are not with us. They are continuing, and ulema do have great influence.
They do have.
And what the government should have been doing is to engaging with the ulema in an informed manner. You see, I have with me right here some quotations which are taught in madrasas, and somebody from the government can have a reasoned debate in a very polite manner, tell them, sir, you are teaching this. Now you tell me, is it possible for somebody who has studied this, who has internalized this, to live in a society like ours, which is multicultural and multi-religious? Is it possible for someone who believes in these things to live next to me? Should I be living next to somebody who has studied this? You tell me. I mean, in a very polite, reasoned manner, we should be engaging with the ulema on these things. Like you mentioned, sir, fatwa. Fatwas of peace. Islam is the religion of peace.
That's right.
These fatwas have come from all over the world from the ulema. They are not effective. There is a reason why they are not effective. This is a question I asked Maulana Mahmood Madani in Pune in a dialogue like this. What is happening? All the ulema will come and tell you, thousands of them will sign this fatwa. I will say, Quran says that killing one innocent person amounts to killing humanity. So Islam has nothing to do, cannot have anything to do with terrorism. But the same ulema will go to their madrasas and teach the children that all the 114 verses teaching pluralism and coexistence and peace have been abrogated by the later Madinan verses of war, and that Islam has to dominate the world. If you are going to become a mufti, there is a iftah course which you do. You are giving some maqasid, which is objectives. Which is, you are told what you have to keep at the back of your mind when you are giving any fatwa. One of those is that Islam has to dominate the world, and it is the religious duty of every Muslim to help that process. So what do you expect? And the most important thing that the government and the society, people like you, can do is to breach the stagnation in the Muslim theological debate.
Absolutely.
There is no debate. What triple talaq has done, Shazia, more than the verdict and more than the good it will bring to some Muslim women, hopefully.
Yes.
What it has done is it has exposed the ulema somewhat.
That's right.
At least one aspect of their thinking. It has breached slightly the stagnation.
The infallibility of the mullah.
Of the mullah. Yes, it has. To a certain extent. But it has to continue. And for instance, I am engaged in this work of creating a new theology of peace and pluralism.
That's right.
What I am doing is using all the trends, like literal trends, defining the words like ijtihad and kufr and kafir and these literally from Quran. One aspect, I am using the rational restraint because in Islam there has been for centuries domination of rationalists. You know, for 500 years there was a golden period in which the rationalist Mu'tazila, they were called Mu'tazila. Mu'tazila Muslims dominated. There were caliphs who were Mu'tazila in Spain and in Baghdad and elsewhere. So I am using their theology and their trends as well as I am using mystical trends from Sufis, their words, which are no longer being taught even in Sufi madrasas in India. So what we, I mean, somebody in the government at some level there has to be, and in the larger society, there has to be this thinking that this is a very important subject. This has to be engaged in before bombs started flying, before an army of suicide bombers is created in India too. Because at the moment, people in Pakistan are busy with themselves. They want to capture Islamabad first. They want to capture Kabul. So we are safe for a little while. But once, you know, they have either captured or they realize that they are not going to go beyond this, their focus will be in India. And believe me, sir, Deobandi Taliban. Now, Taliban, what are Taliban? They were students of Deobandi Madrasa.
Talibs.
Talib means student. These Taliban were just the, is there any difference between the text that is taught in Deoband here and the Deoband there?
No.
Nothing.
They're on a lighter note,
so
Sultan
Saab. People were there.
The huge sectarianism, the warring factions, Ahle Hadith, Ahle Sunnat, Barelvis, Deobandis, hopefully there will be so much of friction and dissonance that the entire ISIS and whatever stands for will be countered at every level by different Maulanas. So that will come to our rescue. I would like to ask the audience if they have any question, because we have only 10 or 15 minutes. Raj, with your permission. Garima, how much time do we have? Yes, 10 minutes max.
More than a question, I think some observations and what I take from your discussions. I'm going to link what you said. It's time for the moderate Muslim to stand up. In a majority, and to what Shazia said in her role as a spokesperson for the BJP. What should the government and the Modi government should, you know, do that? I'm a practicing Muslim. You know, I offer my namaz and I do all of that.
Closer to you.
I'm a practicing Muslim. I offer my namaz. I consider myself as liberal as the word liberal can be. But what I actually sense on the ground today, and this should answer both the points that both of you have made, actually scares me a lot. More than scares me a lot, it troubles me. And I understand the problem the community is going through. And I really appreciate your slides when you don't write Islam and you write jihad. Because that's a narrative that I see in the media. And I'm from the media, having been in the television business for 18 years. I see channels now today, instead of using terror, instead of using jihad, they start writing Muslims. Last night I was aghast when I saw anchor say, 4 Muslims were caught. Okay? So, we keep on saying this, that terror has no religion, but we practice it when we use it in public discourse. That's number one. To your point, when will the majority, or it's time for the majority Muslims to come up? My view on that is, I think the Muslim community, while they try and internalize the problems and solve the problems, because ultimately the battle has to be fought within. It's time for the majority to actually put an arm around them. And when I see what's happening, you know, with the government, and I have a fellow BJP spokesman as a very close friend, and we have these discussions, and I say, for all the good work that you have done, and triple talaq verdict that came out in your tenure, and I actually went on Facebook and I posted that how I wish it was 5-0, not 3-2, and I got attacked for it. What do you do when a chief minister of a state says, I want video recordings from this community, from the madrasas? Had he said that I also want the right wing from the Bajrang Dal, what they do, or the VHP they do, I want that monitored also. That would actually leave a very good impression and a healing hand within the community to say, okay, fine, we've got a person who's really fair and square. At the same point of time, when you have the books being altered, let's face it, Akbar was a great king. He was attacked by people because he practiced more liberal and tolerant Sufism. You know, or he took strands of Sufism to say friendliness and good governance. Or when you start reducing him, you know, there is a problem. There is already a ghetto mentality that exists, and you are going to make it worse. I mean, that's my observation. You know, it's not a question to you people, but to your point, I think it needs a healing hand, but the majority should. But the narrative that I hear today, you know, it really troubles me, and it troubles me as an Indian, not as a Muslim or someone who practices a particular religion. No, I've probably been to more.
It's very easy to be troubled. It's very easy to be enraged. I think we should really start engaging with these issues, talking, and just as much as it is a responsibility for, let's say, a moderate Muslim or liberal Muslim, whatever you want to see me as, it's as much a responsibility on others, non-Muslims, not to put Muslims in this little box.
That's the point. That's what I said. The majority, I think the majority needs to put an arm around. I genuinely feel.
I mean,
without exception. Yeah. Without exception. What you're saying is absolutely right. We have to reach out. We have to, you see, okay. Look, I am a non-political person, so with due apologies to Shahia. Okay, you've now come to the conclusion, look, I don't need the Muslim vote bank to sort of, you know, vote for me. I can do without them. But that does not mean that I excise them and hand them over to the ISI. Let me be quite straightforward and blunt. It is stupid of anybody to think that now, you know, we can have a 70% majoritarian kind of a consolidation. Sorry, that's wrong. And in the military viewpoint, in the army, we don't talk about this, we practice this. Maruf Raza was my student in the Indian Military Academy, gentleman cadet of mine. Look at the boy, the way the boy has come up and grown. I mean, we take pride. There are so many of our Muslim. My first company commander was Major, now Lieutenant Colonel Ahmad Ali Qureshi. I see him, I touch his feet. Because he was my ustad.
Yes.
He taught me. We were taught the moment you enter the you know the barracks, please keep your religion and everything outside. You are Indian first and most, and we are all Indian. That's it. That's it, period. So I think the military thing has now to go out. And this message must never be given, even mistakenly. Look, we don't need you now. You are absolutely right in saying what you are.
But sir, even if
any
that message is being given,
Ratan Saab has a question.
The response of the Muslim should not be medieval.
That's the point.
Response of the Muslim should not be.
See, even if someone else is saying something disturbing and troublesome to you, your response. Now, for instance, Naveed Hamid, who is the president of Muslim Majlis Mashawara, said recently after a meeting of the Mashawara that we may soon have to consider declaring India as Darul Harb.
Yeah.
Now, this kind of medieval thinking, and do you understand the implications of that? Because there are Muslims, very many Muslims, who are so deeply religious, they would be willing to give up their life if you convince them that this is your religion. You see, when Maulana Azad and other people in 1920 gave this verdict that India was a Darul Harb, it was British India.
That's right.
You remember 18 to 36,000, these are the two figures. Between them, maybe something like 20-25,000 families of Indian Muslims at that time left India for Afghanistan. They lost everything because Afghanistan allowed them to enter for a little while, and when they saw there's a whole army coming, then they said, no more entry. So they lost everything. They had left their jobs, they had, you know, sold their houses and everything.
Which actually gets me back to this thing.
Now, let's get some more questions, because I think Ratan Saab had a question. Any others? Please show your hands so we can take the mic. There's one, two. Who else? Raj has a question. Raj does not. Dilip has a question. And so four questions. I will not allow both of you to speak for some time.
We take the basket of questions.
Yes, starting with you, Ratan Saab.
Views expressed by either side has become so strong that we simply don't want to listen to the other side. How many of Muslims would stand up for Sultan Shahin? Forget the Hindus. He's the only person in my so many years of public life, having read so much, who openly says these part of Quran are no more valid and we should stick to what is right. Such people do not get support either from the media, they do not get support from the mainstream, they do not get support from the majority community. So it needs much more courage from the Muslim society to come out this ghetto mentality. Outsiders can come and pat you on the back, but ultimately you have to realize that your misinterpretation is being supported by own so-called Maulana, so-called scholars, who will not come out of this and saying, okay, this may be part of Quran, this may be part of Hadith, but this is not true for today because it's 1400-year-old story. 1400-year-old history, which is no more valid, which is an Arabic tribal society, which is not valid for countries like India or Southeast Asia. So slow grabbing of this pole of belief system is what is hurting Muslim community. It's same on the other side. Whenever I, in social media, I appreciate a Muslim or appreciate a viewpoint, I'm usually hammered by so-called Savarkarites or so-called, you know, more Hindu than me Hindus. So this issue has to be resolved with much more compassion, much more sensitivity than what we are doing today. But there is no way we can negate what is there, and we have to accept it and then move on it. Like Mr. Sutlaj Shahi says, because by trying to say everything is good and hunky-dory and, you know, we are our brothers and all, is fine for, you know, what you call politically correct statements. But ultimately, somebody has to be very honest and blunt about it. RSS Chief Sudarshan Ji had huge arguments and discussions with Maulanas, with priests, and we became very good friends with them. So we need that kind of open discussions and owning up the issues. Only then we can move forward. That means, I mean, you can answer. That's my observation. Having met many people, that's my observation. I just wanted to share.
Great. Yeah. Yes. I have a small question. There is a contradiction.
I'm afraid.
When you said democracy is there, if today somebody goes to Egypt and gets a fair election, I can guarantee you that more than 70% Egyptians will vote for Muslim Brotherhood. No questions about it. What is happening in Egypt? Muslim Brotherhood.
Brotherhood.
There's no question about it. That is one question. That's a contradiction here. And second question is, actually, Mr. Sultan, you sound like music into my ear. In all honesty, I read a little bit of Holy Quran, and I have a simple question to ask. I read Mahabharata also, and Mahabharata is book of parvs. Kehte kitabo parv ki kitab hai. Waise hi Quran Sharif is kitabul surah, surah ki kitab hai, chapters. And the first chapter of Quran Sharif is Surah Bakar. What is Surah Bakar? What does Bakar means? Cow. If one Maulana stands up and says Holy Quran starts with the cow, all your debates finish. Anybody has guts? Anybody can say the Holy Quran starts with the cow? Bakar does not mean Bakra. It is Surah Bakra. And if somebody reads Surah Bakra, it has amazing facts in there. I don't remember exactly the quotes, but it's a huge one.
Please keep it short. Okay, we'll let you answer that. But just, Sultan Sahib, just give me a minute because let's finish with the questions and then we can have a concluding remarks from
both. Well, a very good afternoon to you, and thank you for a wonderful, wonderful enlightenment and wonderful talk. Obviously, it seems to be quite clear that there is something lost in translation with the rhetoric or the appeal that the other more radicalized side of Islam has succeeded, as we were talking earlier on, Sultanji, in managing to communicate to the people. What positive steps, and we have a lady here who is, well, not today, but I mean, she is from, does represent, what would you recommend in concrete terms to be able to dispel this disbelief of certain words like jihad, which are constantly gaining momentum and perhaps distorting a lot of things that you have talked about, which need to be heard? So how would you recommend it in terms of people here from the media, the Zulfikar, who is on a channel owners, and I mean, I think that there should be a practical, how would you like to see it, Sultanji?
Well, to begin with, first thing is Muslims will have to decide if they want to live in the 21st century. If they do, and the world will have to decide if they want to live with the Muslims in close proximity, or do they want to give one part of the earth planet to Muslims to live alone, you know, because the way Islamic theology is evolving and has evolved and has become universalized now, more or less, I mean it is on the way. It has become practically impossible for a Muslim who believes in this theology to actually coexist with other communities. You see, the theology that we have today, and this is not only Wahhabism, this is all the theologies, this is the Brahmi theology also, with slight differences, certainly. In this theology, the only relationship of a Muslim with others is that of war. No other relationship, no coexistence in this theology, and no effort is being made. You see, it is the Muslim community, as I told you before, that any community which is capable of producing a whole army of suicide bombers anywhere in the world should have been worried. It's not. That is my biggest worry, because my community is not worried, doesn't seem to appear to be taking it seriously. Then what is happening? Where are things going wrong? What has happened to us? How will we live in this society? So once we Muslims first decide that yes, we have to live, this is a multicultural world, this is 21st century, we are no longer living in the 7th century AD, we are living here in the 21st century world of internet and television and everything that we have today, then we will have to adjust our theology, we will have to think our theology, and revolutionary changes will have to be made. This gentleman talked about Quran and Surah Baqarah and all that. What has happened in the Quran is, when you compile a book, see, the Prophet did not compile this book. This compilation was done about 20 years later. That's when you compile a book, you have some ways of doing it. Like, one is subject wise, you will have all the verses on one subject in one chapter, etc. What they have done is, there is just no continuity, consistency in Quran. Every surah, I mean, one verse now you read is from now, and one verse was 10 years older, and one verse is 10 years later. I mean, there is no consistency. So, and then what has happened is that the present Quran gives primacy to Madinan verses of war. What we will have to do to begin with, and the only way I think that Quran can be compiled, is by doing it as much as possible in the original way in which God sent it to us. God's choice of which verse to send first is more important. And this would give primacy to Makkan verses of peace and pluralism, which it doesn't have now. All of them have been bunched together at the end. You don't reach that end. Surah Baqarah, for instance, has so many verses from so many parts. Some of them are very good, some of them are Makkan verses. So this is one thing. Another thing is hadith. We will have to just rationally think that anything, you see, now I am talking, if all of you were to sit down right now and write what I have said, all of you will write it differently in your own language. Some of you may even say things that I have not said or may contradict me. If you can do that right now, then imagine somebody telling you that my grandfather told me that his grandfather had told him that his uncle was going somewhere
thousands of years
and met somebody 100 years ago, 200 years ago. What kind of rational sanctity it has? And yet, every Maulana, every Alim from every school of thought says that hadith, so-called sayings of God, sayings of Muhammad, are akin to revelation. Now, revelation is Quran. Now, when Quran was coming, there used to be katibs around Muhammad all the time, even in the night.
Katibs and then calligraphers.
To write it down immediately. But hadith is something which was in the collection, started 100 years after his demise and continued until 300 years. And it was studied by various imams 220 years after Muhammad, 250 years after Muhammad, and so on and so forth. What kind of, any rational person will have to think that this cannot be called sayings of Muhammad. The most I can say, so some of them are very good hadiths, very good teachings. But if I like a teaching and if I think that this accords well with both Quran and the personality of Muhammad, then the most I can say about any hadith rationally is that maybe the Prophet said something like this. Even if I like it, I cannot say the Prophet said this. I can at most say that possibly the Prophet did say something like this, because it seems to accord with the spirit of Islam, the spirit of Quran, and the spirit of the personality of the Muhammad that I have assessed. So Muslims will, we don't have much time, but I will just say that Muslims will need to first make a decision that yes, we do want to live with our neighbors all over the world in this 21st century. We are living in 21st century now. This is not 7th, 8th, 9th century. And that we have to live here. First they decide that, and once they decide that, then they will have to make revolutionary changes in their theology.
Jayabakshi?
Yep.
Okay, last question. Sorry. And the last answer.
Yeah.
And we'll call it a day.
Yeah, I refer to a book by Noah Harari, the author of Sapiens, and currently there's a Homo Deus. He says, historically, most religions have promised two things: reduce sufferings, increase happiness. All the religions, uniformly. Perhaps Islam also did that. Now, post-industrial revolution, science and technology not only promised it, but delivered it. So most developing countries which believed in the science and technology gave their total reliance on religion for seeking these two things. So perhaps a lot of Western world and the newer Eastern economies have moved away from religion. Do you think that's yet to happen in Islam? One. Two, we kept discussing about the role of moderate Muslims. I think it is futile fighting religious ideology with counter-religious ideology. Moderate Muslims have to promote scientific research and learning. Then you will start, you know, if you find a drug addict, make him play football. Don't counsel him on wrong, evil doings of drugs. Make him play football, he'll naturally forget illness, this thing. So I just want to pose this as a...
Okay. But we'll leave it to Jayan Bakshi, and then I think we'll...
Yeah, okay. Shall I?
Yes,
okay.
Please.
That's precisely the first slide that we started with, that when angst arose in Islam as a result of the collision with the Western civilization, the conclusions that they unfortunately came to was not that we need to modernize, we need to imbibe science and technology, we need to keep pace, but that we have lost our original purity. We lost because we were not as the pure Islam that we were in the 7th century AD, and there was a going backwards. You know, you go backwards in time to a time warp in the 7th century AD, as he very rightly said. So the fact is, I would come back, because I have also had occasion in Jammu and Kashmir and elsewhere to discuss with a whole range of Islamic scholars and others, and I'm very gratified to note that voices like his are coming up. They need to now reach out, and some soul searching. Who likes being searched at every airport just because you have a particular name? And you are singled out, brought out, humiliated. You see, so the thing will, impulse will have to come from within the community. And as I said, and actually I think what you said, more or less, it conforms to the conclusions that we came to. Ijma, ijtihad, and the hadiths. We will have to downplay the hadiths. You know, if Islam is to evolve and come into a more, let us say, harmonious kind of a relationship with the other, you know, religions and societies, you know, then the hadiths possibly will have to be downplayed. The ijtihad portion will have to be raised. He pointed out practical difficulties with the ijma, wherein the Muslim scholars or the ulema take over and say this is ijma. Whereas now with democratic processes, polls, the way of ascertaining the view of every Muslim, you know, yes, all over the globe, all over the country, you could get back to these two. It will have to come from within the community. The rest of us will have to facilitate, help that process, which is the point that he very largely made. We'll have to facilitate that process, but the basic thing has to now come within. And the day the moderate Muslim majority decides to stand up, we will see the end of these troubles. I saw this happening in the Punjab. I have full faith. It is already started happening. The fact that they have spoken in the tone and tenor that they have is a very, very welcome sign. I hope and pray there are more sane voices like this, and they must come up from within Islam. Nobody else can force a reform. Nobody else can help Islam evolve. the Islam will have to evolve itself to come to conclusions with what are the contexts that we must refer to, and those which are the context is now outdated. Possibly we have to go to the core perennial philosophy in the Quran. And let me say, you know, it is the same everywhere. Aldous Huxley's perennial philosophy, it's the same everywhere. That is what the Sufis say. And that's what, I mean, my father used to take me to Sufi, you know, kalams. They are beautiful.
Yes.
We would love to participate.
Well, as you know, there are no easy answers, and there is not one point of view to even counter this. This has been a great discussion, really, and we would never see a discussion or hear a discussion like this on television, because this was informed and introspective and honest, and there was no need for us to subscribe to any particular point of view with an agenda, which is what happens on television very often. To conclude, I would say that while I agree that hadith has to be, Quran has to be uplifted, and the word of Quran must be supreme as opposed to the word of hadith and the million versions of it. But the immutability of Quran also has to be questioned, and very few people have the guts or the gumption to take on that as Sultan Saab does, and very few Islamic scholars, so to speak. In the Indian context, while it's a unique situation, because Indian Muslims in India are the second largest Muslim population in the world. But as opposed to theocratic states where they live, Indian Muslims here follow the civil law, as in they follow the IPC on civil matters. In terms of criminal matters, they follow the CRPC. But when it comes to personal law, and that is, I don't know whether to call it a fault of the founding fathers or their fear or lack of consensus at that point of time, that they follow personal laws, and we're seeing some of that. So I think in the Indian context, it's really important for government to take an unequivocal, unambiguous stand to look at what is going on within the community with compassion, with inclusiveness, and not with a danda, so to speak, and fear and suspicion. And also for Indian Muslim to see themselves as democratic citizens, not just members of a religious community, not just Muslim women being Muslim women, but as worthy of taking from the Indian constitution as Indian citizens, as Indian citizens. So that's another civic identity we have to work towards in India. Thank you so much. This was a great panel, and many, many thanks to both of you.